One of the main reasons for the popularity of artificial neural networks is the flexibility of the approach. It turns out that neural networks can represent basically any function that you want to approximate to any precision, of course given enough model parameters. Now this is a fact given by the universal approximation theorem, and essentially it says that we can use neural networks for all sorts of problems where we want to recover complex function mappings from input to output. And so far we, for example, have been very much interested in finding such mappings from input to output in the context of regression and classification. Now this slide shows the universal approximation theorem. And we're not going to use this video to prove this theorem. We're just going to use it to gain some understanding and see what this theorem actually implies. So let's start off by reading what it says. So first of all, we're dealing with function f, so that can be any continuous function on a compact area Rd. And this will be the function that we're going to approximate with a neural network. Now such neural networks are based on these linear layers and activation functions. And let now this h be the activation function. So the activation function of my neural network, which can be anything, but it cannot be polynomial. So that's the only criteria that we have. So what we then consider, we consider a two-layer neural network, as we've seen in the previous lecture. And we're going to use this neural network to approximate this function that we started off with, right? And we're going to approximate it to some precision epsilon, so some small positive number, such that for every point x, these functions are very close to each other, where closeness is given by this small number epsilon. Then this theorem says that there exist two-layer neural networks that can become arbitrarily close to my function f that I want to approximate, where closeness is controlled via this epsilon parameter. And this means the smaller or the higher my precision, the more number of hidden units I need. But it is possible to find such a number of hidden units that allows me to construct such a model that comes arbitrarily close to my function. Switching back to this basis function viewpoint, my two-layer neural networks learn these basis functions phi m of my input x. And so basically these construct complex feature vectors, which in turn are used in this linear model and that is given by my two-layer neural network. And this two-layer neural network can then be arbitrarily close to the function that I want to approximate. Now, I want to gain some intuition of what this theorem essentially tells us. And I'm going to do that by starting off with ReLU-based neural networks. So basically, this theorem says I can choose any activation function I like, as long as it isn't polynomial. Now, the ReLU was this max of 0 and a. So with the ReLU, I can also come arbitrarily close to any function that I want to approximate. And I'm going to show this as follows. First of all, recall that this first layer can be interpreted as generating these basis functions, right? I have m of such basis functions after the first layer, and these basis functions are defined via m of such linear mappings that are then pulled to such a ReLU activation function. And this ReLU makes sure that all these values become positive. Okay, so I have m sets of weights. Now let's take a look at the 1D case. So let's suppose my input is one-dimensional. Then what my first set of linear weights does, it assigns some slope. So it creates these linear functions by multiplying x with the weight of my first basis function in the first layer, plus some bias, okay? So that generates this linear function, and then I apply a ReLU to it. So I'm only going to take the positive part of this. So that means that everything below zero is mapped to zero, actually, and that actually gives me then my first basis function. So this would be phi one of x. Okay, now let's consider a different m, so basically the next activation in my first layer. So suppose maybe this one has a negative slope. So it would generate this linear function given by W2. So that was my second activation of the first layer times x. So that's this slope plus some bias. Okay, and also this one isn't activated with the ReLU, which truncates everything at zero. So if I take the ReLU of this thing, well, we got this positive basis function. So this would give me phi 2 of x. Okay, now let's consider also a third basis function, which maybe has a slope and a bias, which creates this linear function over here, which is also truncated at zero via this ReLU activation function. So that will give me the third basis function. Okay, so what I just drew was this first layer, right? So these linear components, I had m is a tree. I had three of such basis functions in the end that for every x provide a particular activation. Then what happens in the next layer is I'm going to take linear combinations again of these activations. So essentially linear combinations of these basis functions. So that allows me to give a response for every possible x. So let me draw that what's happening here. So that means also my final output is going to be a function of x, and it will be given by the weighted sum. So really this linear combination. So I assign a weight in my second layer to each of these basis functions. So that's what my output is going to look like. Okay, now let's move from left to right. So on the left, we only have really one basis function that is active, and let's just give it like a positive weight, weight 1. So I really replicate this basis function over here. Then my function remains 0 for a while, and then this particular basis function kicks in. Let's also give it a positive weight. So, well, the function starts increasing. Then this particular basis function kicks in. And let's assign it a negative weight. So if I add this slope, well, make it negative, let's subtract this slope to this one, then maybe the function starts to look something like this. So essentially what is happening here, that with such ReLU-based activation functions, I create basis functions that look something like this, that are only activated for particular values of x and are zero otherwise. And then if I start to make linear combinations of these basis functions, then I get the result that my resulting functions, they will become piecewise linear, where we transition from one linear piece to the other. So here I have a linear piece, here it's constant zero, here I have a linear piece, and here the transitioning between these points take place at the locations where my basis functions become active. Okay, so that's the core idea behind neural networks with values, that I'm able to construct functions that are piecewise linear. And then the universal approximation theorem says that I can use these piecewise linear functions, so these two-layer neural networks, to approximate any function to arbitrary precision. So let this be the function that we want to approximate. And let this, for example, be the epsilon interval which we need to stay within. So that defines the regions that I'm allowed to pass through with my function. Then if I'm going to approximate this with a piecewise linear function, I could do something like this, like a segment over here, over here, over here. So in that sense, I can approximate this function with only three basis functions. Now, if I'm going to reduce the interval, so I make epsilon smaller, then I have to stay close to my data, or I have to stay close to my signal that I want to approximate. Okay, then I can still can basically work with more of these piecewise linear functions. And in this particular case, I need, let's say, 9 basis functions. So with m is 9, I can now approximate my signal to a closer precision, so for a smaller epsilon. Okay, so this is a sort of visual proof that I can approximate any continuous signal with just these piecewise linear ReLU networks up to some arbitrary precision. And if I want to approximate this closer and closer, I basically need more and more of these basis functions. And with more basis functions, I mean more and more hidden units. Which this M represented the number of hidden units in my two-layer neural network. Okay, then it follows by induction that deeper neural networks also have this property. And then we can talk about what is the most efficient way of starting approximating or constructing these complex functions? And let's consider the following. Let's say we have a neural network with L layers. So this is a deep neural network. Then we can approximate this deep neural network with a shallow neural network, let's say with only L prime layers, because that's what our universal approximation theorem says, right? I can approximate any function, so also this deep neural network, with a shallow neural network with only L prime layers, right? And I can approximate this deep neural network then with a shallow neural network up to some arbitrary precision parameter epsilon. Then it turns out that the number of hidden units that I need to approximate this deeper neural network scales exponentially with decreasing epsilon. So with, if I want to be more precise, I need an exponential growth in the number of hidden units. And this in turn implies that approximation with deep neural networks is more parameter efficient. Now maybe let's take a second thought on that in the context of these ReLU networks. So in ReLU networks, we saw that the expressive power of such a ReLU-based deep neural networks is associated with the number of linear regions, right? So because we have a ReLU network leads to these piecewise linear neural networks. And well, the more pieces I have, the more accurate my predictions or my approximations become. And the number of regions that I can represent with ReLU-based deep neural networks scales with the width, so it scales polynomial in width, but it scales exponentially with depth. And in this case, this D is the input dimension. So the most efficient way of gaining more region is not to widen my network, so to add more hidden units per layer, but simply to go deeper and consider more layers, right? Because then let's say I have a fixed number of parameters that I can spend, and I can distribute them over my network, design different networks so I can make choices. And the number of parameters as a function of width scales quadratically, because in these neural networks, I want to connect every input to the output of the, well, the next layer. So that's, let's say, width times width, number of parameters I need there. And then for each layer, I need this quadratic number of parameters. So my total number of parameters is given by width squared times depth. So when I'm then told, okay, this is the number of parameters that you can spend, now make your choices based on the width and the depth of the networks, then, well, it's clearly that most expressive power is gained by going deeper with maybe less neurons per layer, so with less hidden units per layer, then staying shallow with more neurons per layer. And then this also explains the popularity of deep neural networks versus shallow neural networks, simply because these deeper neural networks were able to perform more complex tasks. And this was sort of empirically discovered, but it was also theoretically proven via such statements. So building deeper neural networks is better in terms of expressive power and the type of problems that you can solve than staying shallow. Okay, so let's take a look at some examples of such function approximations. Maybe first of all, what kind of problem does this correspond to? Are we now talking about classification or are we talking about regression? We're talking about regression, right? Because our objective is to map any input to a corresponding output value. So these input-output pairs are now given via my ground truth function f of x. So in this particular case, f of x is x squared, and we sample 50 points of this. So these are these blue dots, so those form my input-output pairs, which we're going to reconstruct with a neural network. And our neural network is a two-layer neural network with only three hidden units and a 10 tangent hyperbolic activation function and only one linear output, right? Because I want to predict this particular value. So my neural network really looks something like this. So I have my input x, then we have this hidden unit. So I have only three hidden units. So this would be set one. And I apply a 10H on these activations on these hidden units. And these are then combined via my output weights, so W2, to my prediction. Okay, and recall that these hidden units, like just before the output layer, take on the interpretation as my feature vector, right? So these hidden units as a function of x for my basis functions, that I can use to obtain my final prediction. And you see, with only three of such basis functions, we can take linear combinations of these to form this parabolic shape over here. So we actually have a perfect reconstruction. Now, figure B is then, we're trying to approximate a sine of x. And also here we see, so that's really nice, this idea that we're learning these basis functions. And with these three type of basis functions, I can assign weights to these basis functions, and that would give me the sine reconstruction. Now, these are nice, smooth, continuous functions, but we can also approximate, for example, the absolute value of x, and then we have this sharp transition going on over here. So overall, we have a good approximation, but we see that the approximation wiggles a bit, and here it takes a shortcut. So, of course, we make some errors, and this basically implies that we need more hidden units to also represent these sharp details. And then in figure D, we try to approximate the Heaviside step function hx. So it really takes on the value 0 below this threshold, and then it jumps to 1. So also, again, a very sharp transition. So we see that now actually our neural networks learns these basis functions that are also on or off at particular regions. And, well, a linear combination of, well, these basis functions then allows me to make this step function approximation. So these are just some examples of functions that we can approximate. And in practice, that's also what we're doing with regression problems, right? We want to recover some function mapping. We do not know it, but we have these input-output pairs, and that's what we recover. And basically, our universal approximation theorem says that, well, if my network is deep enough or if it's wide enough, at least I would be able to represent it. And now the challenge is, of course, to actually find this particular model. Using, for example, gradient descent optimization of some loss. I'll talk about it in the upcoming videos, but that's essentially what we're doing here, function approximation. Okay, and then I want to give this example again, go back to this ReLU approximations, because I really like this idea of piecewise linear function approximation and the idea that we have these basis functions that are learned in this process. So this is the result if I want to approximate the sine wave with a two-layer neural network with only three hidden units. And so this is when I trained it and it converged. And this is, for example, what I start off with. So I initialize with some random weights and biases, and then I'm going to minimize some loss function. So I make all these errors, and I want to minimize these errors. And that's a criterion that I'm minimizing. And then I apply some iterative scheme over here, and you see that my basis functions start to adapt to something useful, right? And we also see that the points where these piecewise linear functions transition exactly take place at the points where my basis functions are active or inactive. Okay, but it cannot come perfectly close, right? Because it's too simple a model. For example, especially here, I'm making some errors. So if we really want to improve our representation or approximation, then we really should increase the number of hidden units in our network. So that's shown over here in the right figure, right? So let's say I initialize my model randomly with a set of weights. So each, let's say, basis function gets its own slope and an offset. And then I start this learning process, and I'm going to optimize my weights iteratively. And you see it nicely converges to the actual signal. And again, we see that we actually have learned all these nice basis functions with a particular slope and a particular offset, like an on-off location, and that determines these transition points. Okay, but this is just essentially another example of my universal approximation theorem at work. Where, of course, it's the fact that I worked with ReLU activation functions to obtain these nice piecewise linear approximations. So all this was talk about regression, essentially, but function approximation also takes a role in the classification with neural networks, right? So let's suppose I have this data and it's drawn from some underlying distribution, and these underlying distributions determine a true decision boundary. So that's what you see in green. So in green is what you see, where the true posterior distribution for x equals the posterior distribution for class 2. So these decision boundaries are essentially obtained as the zero level set or some level set of a function that we are now going to approximate. Okay, so this is then a classification problem where the blue points correspond to class 1, for example, and the red points correspond to class 2. So then again, let's think about what we're doing. So we're how many inputs do we have? Well, we have two inputs. We have this two-dimensional data set. How many output units do I need? So I'm now designing my neural network, right? So how many output units do I need? Right, I'm actually only need one output, right? Because I have this binary classification task. So the probability for the other class is given by 1 minus my probability for the first class. I could still encode this with actually two outputs and then work with a softmax, but this is completely unnecessary, right? It's a waste of parameters. So I only consider one output, and I'm just going to make the choice to work with only two hidden units. And I'm going to work with a 10H activation function. And because I'm considering classification, my neural network should spit out a number between 0 and 1 because my prediction should represent some probability. So my output activation is going to be sigma, the sigmoid. Okay, so then my objective is really to recover this true posterior distribution. And okay, now I'm training this neural network, and this red line is what comes out. So this red line is obtained via my two-layer neural network with only two hidden units. Okay, so this is a very simple approximation. It does make this division quite okay, but if I want to really improve on this, so essentially if I want to reduce my epsilon in my function approximation, recall that I'm approximating this function now with a neural network, then essentially this tells me in order to represent such complex shapes, I should increase the number of hidden units. Okay, to conclude, we can formulate regression as well as classification problems as function approximation problems, where in the regression case, we really want to recover the true function mapping between input-output pairs. And in classification, we can consider it as approximating my posterior distributions. Then the universal approximation theorem then says that if I go deep enough, or if I have enough hidden units, then at least I would be able to represent this true function. And now the challenge is, of course, to actually find this function. So now we're talking about optimization and minimizing error functions. And that's going to be the topic of the remaining videos on neural networks.